My name is Tony and I work for Department of Agriculture and Fisheries Forest Science. As forest scientists, we need to know how the condition of the forest or plantation changes over time. And to do this, we establish monitoring plots.
Learning how to assess a forest properly is a great way to increase your understanding of your plantation or native forest, which will help you make better forest management decisions. There are many reasons to carry out forest assessments, such as collecting data for a forest management plan, assessing survival rates after planting, estimating the timber volume and value, estimating the carbon stored in a forest, and assessing forest health. The reason for carrying out a forest assessment will determine the level of accuracy and resources required. Generally, the aim is to obtain an unbiased estimate of the condition of the forest, with results that are as accurate as possible, that is, close to the true values, with a high level of certainty or precision. The equipment you will need is a 50 metre tape, a GPS device or a smartphone, a map of the forest area, a clinometer or an app on a smartphone, a calculator and or slope correction tables, painted treated timber pegs or star pickets, and spray paint. To establish monitoring plots, there are several steps to follow. We begin by identifying the total area of the forest and dividing this area into uniform sections. Next, we determine the plot type, size, and the number of plots required. We then site the plots throughout the forest area in a non-biased way, navigate to them, and mark them in the field. The first step in the process is to identify the area of forest that you want to measure. This is called the net forest area, and it excludes non-forested areas such as roads, tracks, dams, or buildings. There are a number of ways to calculate the net forest area. The most accurate method is to use a GPS device to walk around the edge of your forest, using the edge of the tree crowns as the boundary. A second method, which is less accurate, is to measure the forest area using a mapping service such as Google Maps. On the desktop, this doesn't work on a phone, switch to satellite mode, zoom into the forest area until you can see the boundary and right-click on a corner. Select the measure distance option to start, then left-click to drop more points around the boundary. When you've completed the boundary, click on the starting point again and the area will be displayed in metres squared. Divide by 10,000 to give the area in hectares. Each point can be dragged if required. If the net forest area is small, less than 3 hectares, it may be simpler to measure every tree rather than establishing plots. Likewise, in a small plantation, every second or third tree could be measured. However, if the area is larger than 3 hectares, or in native forests, establishing plots allows you to measure a representative sample and then extrapolate the data to the whole forest. This approach saves time and money. Within larger forests, there is often variation due to forest or vegetation types, soil types, areas affected by fire or storms, year of planting, tree species, thinning or pruning activities, and fertilising. If there are variations within your forest, you should divide the area into more uniform sections, known as strata, and treat these sections separately. This will minimise the variability within each stratum, reduce the number of plots to be measured, save cost and effort, and provide a more accurate result. To assist with stratifying a forest based on the vegetation type, regional ecosystem maps are available free of charge via this Queensland Government website. Or, on the Queensland Globe website, add layers, expand biodata, flora and fauna, and tick regional ecosystem mapping. Other strata may be created according to your knowledge of previous management activities or weather events, or they may be identified through field observations or aerial photography. If your forest requires stratification, mark the boundaries of each stratum on a map, calculate the area of each stratum, and treat these areas separately. There are three main types of plots commonly used in forest measurement: circular plots, rectangular plots, and strip plots or transects. Any of these plot types can be used depending on which is most suitable for your situation. Circular plots are suited to large areas of native vegetation. They are easier to lay out in the field than rectangular plots. A typical plot may be 1/20th of a hectare, which equates to a circle with a radius of 12.62 metres. These are established at regular intervals throughout the forest. Rectangular plots are suited to plantations where trees are in clear rows, or narrow plantings such as shelter belts. Strip plots or transects are another option and are relatively easy to set up. For example, you may establish a strip plot by sampling 5 metres either side of a central line, 100 metres long, which would give a plot area of 1,000 square metres or 1/10 of a hectare. In this video, we will demonstrate circular plots.
The plot size is based on the number of trees that will be included in each plot. The aim is to sample 10 to 20 trees in a plot, so the more sparse the trees, the larger the plot needs to be. In general, native forests require larger plots than plantations.
To calculate the plot size, an initial estimate of the tree density, or the number of trees per hectare, is required. You may already know this number in a plantation situation, or you may have to count the number of trees in a couple of pilot plots to find out. Dividing the number of trees by the area of the pilot plots in hectares gives the tree density, or stocking rate. This table provides a guide to the appropriate plot size according to the stocking rate. For circular plots, the formula for the area of a circle can be used to calculate the plot radius on flat ground. If the plot is situated on sloping ground more than 10 degrees, the plot radius must be adjusted to ensure the correct area is assessed. We'll cover this later. Once the appropriate plot size is determined, the same area should be used throughout the stratum.
To properly work out the number of plots to be sampled requires statistical calculations. However, as a general guide, around 0.5 to 2% of the net forest area should be sampled. If the forest is large or fairly uniform, sample about 0.5%. If it is small or relatively diverse, sample up to 2%. The number of plots required also depends on how precise you need the results to be and the resources available.
For example, if your net forest area is 30 hectares with not too much variation, you might sample 1% of the area, which is 0.3 of a hectare or 3,000 square metres. If your plot size is 0.05 hectares or 500 square metres, you would need 6 plots. For each stratum, ensure that you have enough plots, at least 2, and that the forest has been correctly stratified. Create additional plots or strata if required.
To provide statistically valid results, sample plots must be randomly located within the net forest area. We need to take care not to introduce bias into the data by choosing locations in the field that are easy to access or where the trees look best. It's better practice, therefore, to decide on the location of the plots in advance on a map and to navigate to those locations.
One way to do this is by overlaying a grid onto a map of the forest and systematically locating a plot point on the map at each intersection of the grid lines or every second or third intersection within the net forest area. This will give random plot locations as the grid is initially placed over the map at random without influence from conditions in the field. Write down the coordinates for each plot from the map to use in the next step. The easiest and most accurate way of navigating to plot locations is to use a handheld GPS device. Simply enter the coordinates of your plot and navigate to it following the arrow. It is also possible to use Google Maps on a smartphone, although this is not so accurate and may not work well under canopy cover.
To collect unbiased data, every plot should be measured at its predefined location. That means if a plot falls in part of the net forest area that has very few trees, it should still be measured and should not be abandoned or moved. Similarly, heavy weed growth or steep slopes are not reasons to abandon a plot. However, if reaching a plot would endanger your safety, then another location may be chosen instead.
If you are establishing plots for ongoing measurements, they should be marked out in the field so that anyone can easily find them and identify plot trees in future years. To do this, record the exact coordinates at the plot centre for circular plots or at the plot corners for rectangular or strip plots using the GPS. Use painted treated timber pegs or star pickets to mark the plots in the field. Label them with a plot number using permanent paint or a durable tag. If the plot slope is greater than 10 degrees, the area to be included and therefore the radius must be adjusted. To do this, stand in the centre of the plot and measure the slope along the steepest part of the plot to a point on the boundary using a clinometer or smartphone app. Ensure that you sight to a location that is at the same height as your eye, and remember to record the measurement in degrees. Rotate 180 degrees and repeat the process in the opposite direction. Average the two figures and use a table such as this one to determine the corrected slope radius. Alternatively, use this equation. For example, if the plot radius for flat ground is 12.62 metres and the slope of your plot is 16 degrees, the corrected radius to use would be 12.87 metres. If you are using Microsoft Excel to calculate the slope radius, remember that Excel uses radians instead of degrees. Using the same example as before, enter the formula in Excel like this. Using the correct radius for the slope, number each tree within the plot boundary until a complete circle is marked. Numbers should face the centre of the plot. Check the distance to the centre as required. At times you will find trees that are right on the edge of the plot, called borderline trees. If more than half the stem at 1.3 metres of height is inside the plot, then the tree should be included. If not, do not include that tree in the plot. When you have marked out the plot, you can proceed to measure various aspects of the trees within it. For more details on this part of the process, watch the next video on measuring trees.